mic is not on.
Yes. They want it louder.
Okay, I can make that one louder.
Okay. Maybe if everyone quiets down, it's not loud enough. Some people are nodding and saying, yes, it's loud.
Can no, hear me? It's not loud enough.
It's your birthday?
He's working out. Okay. We want to be sure and be able to get your questions answered today. How's that sound? A little better?
Better.
Okay. Great. Take it over.
Okay, we'd like to begin on time because we have a very full morning. First, we're going to hear presentations by Alex Cohen and Harvey Cohn about the various options that they have worked out for us to choose from. We then are going to, actually at your seats, you'll find a pencil and index cards. And they are for your writing questions and passing them to Selma and to Dorothea for discussion by the two panelists. At the same time, we will have a sign-up sheet passed for those who want to verbally direct questions or make a statement. We really expect this morning not to be a final meeting. There will be another meeting we expect in January where the public will be heard again very fully. This morning is for the presentation, and it's a culmination of some very hard work and thoughtful planning.
Could you put the mic in front of your mouth, please?
Thoughtful planning on the part of our master planners. So we hope you will listen carefully and absorb what they have to say and have feedback in terms of written questions and verbal questions. I think that's it.
Okay.
Alex Cohen.
Harvey Cohen.
I am Alex Cohen. Just give me a raise of hands. How many of you were here during the last presentation that we had here? Okay, so a majority of people here were at the previous discussion. I'm going to just give you a little bit of background for the people who haven't been to a public presentation or wasn't part of that last conversation. In respect to the people who've been here, you're probably hear a couple of the same sort of themes again. I've shortened it because during the last conversation, we're really giving you our feedback from our assessment process. So the last conversation was really about our assessment and the different findings that we found and some ideas. And really what we were trying to do is sort of push out the goalposts, pull back the goalposts, try to feel out where the community is on their library and the future of their library. So just to start, whenever we work with communities, we use this methodology. And just to give you a little bit of background on myself, I'm a library consultant. I'm working on 8 different libraries as we speak. None of them are alike. Some of them are research libraries associated with museums. Some of them are research libraries associated with the federal government. Others are public libraries. Others are international libraries. Others are digital libraries. So we work all across with all different types of communities. And the one thing that is similar among every library is an appreciation for really the 3 elements The three elements being the collection, the seating, and the staff. Now, the collection is a really difficult topic to talk about, because the collection is the collection when you plant the seed for a library, you start to share collections in your community, whatever type of community it is, and as you share those collections, the collection grows and it gets enriched, and it's almost like I describe it like a rose bush. At a certain point, you need to trim back the rose bush to really get the beautiful buds. So the collection is the first element. The second element is the user seating. And the user seating I'm going to talk a little bit about today, and you'll see how the transformation of the library in retrospect to the collection and the user seating is playing out. And that's where some very interesting discussions will come out. And then thirdly, I want to talk a little bit about the staff. So we really have three elements: the library collection, the library seating, and the library staff. And all three of those turn into a plan. And in this case, Harvey Cohn will be speaking after me, and he will be showing you options that take in all three of those variables, and they play around with them as options for future solution. So just a little bit, let me back up here. So what we started was, we started with the idea of what gives life to this library. It's on Library Lane. That's a significant piece, but it's also part of a park, and believe it or not, I've worked on many libraries that have a park-like atmosphere. So there's the front lawn and all of that. And so we really wanted to understand to appreciate the best parts of the library. And then now what we're doing is we're really in the dream stage of what might be. And I'm going to show you a couple of programmatic options to give you an idea of where we're coming from, and how you might use technology to improve that, to improve the sustainability of the library and provide you with more collections. Because really the important piece of a library is that building of collections, sharing of collections, accessing collections, and the programs that go with those collections. And it can be pretty abstract. So what we want to do is we want to go from what might be to what should be. And we're really not at the what should be stage yet. So today is really about showing you what might be. We've worked on this project now since the summertime, so we've thought a lot about the town, we've thought a lot about the library, we've looked at the site, we've talked to many people. We have probably not talked to enough, so I just want to say one other piece about this conversation. This conversation doesn't end today. Given that we want to get across a lot of information in a short period of time, we've given you cards, and those cards are really meant to do two things. One, to have a question and answer session at the end of this presentation. But two, just as important, to include any of those questions online and have the conversation continue in social media.
On the
web page. On the web page that the library has set up. So just a little background about our work. So we did 10 visual scans with the help of the library board, which was fantastic. I'll say the first time in my career that I've had a library board actually do more work than we did, really. They took in this idea of the visual scan, and they really wanted to know from as many people as they could. Usually we do, say, 2 to 4 visual scans in a library to get an understanding of what we need to do. But the board felt very strongly at getting as much input as possible, and it played out in the visual scans. And I just want to recognize that the board, you know, this is volunteer work. The board took their time out to scan the library with community members. They didn't just, you know, sit and wait for the library planner or the architect to do it for them. They felt really that they had to do it themselves. So I just want to stress that this plan, what the results of this plan, is because of the input from the community, and the input has been excellent. Sometimes when we try to do a visual scan, we get 2 or 3 people, and we get apologies from the library. I had it happen in upstate New York 2 weeks ago. Went up for visual scans, hardly happened. You know what that says about the community to me? That we have a problem. But it's a different problem than you have here. You have people who are really impassioned, right? As opposed to apathetic. Remember that, because that's a big difference in this town versus another place in New York, not far from here. Well, kind of far. Anyway, back to the visual scan. The results of the visual scan said really one main piece, which was, we are a neighborhood library. We don't want somebody to come in and build us something obelisk or whatever it is. And we want to appreciate that we are a community and that we share. And so when we did the visual scan, what we've consistently found is when we walked up to this spot, right where we were standing, and we stood there, we looked out at the door, I asked the group, and then the library board had the same thing happen. The consistent grade, now we grade each space. So basically, you tour the library spaces, and you grade them. And the reason why we do that is because I'm not an architect. Okay? I'm a librarian. My dad's an architect. My partner here is an architect. But we look at things differently. Architects look at things differently. So in order for us to get to do our job right, we need a consensus approach. We need to understand what everybody's seeing. So feedback is really important to the process. I just want to stress that, because when we came back, it wasn't me. I wasn't the person saying this is an A space. I was trying to pick it apart. Why is it an A? Tell me why. It'd be easier to change this than to keep it the same. So tell me why it's so good. And it was one day there's somebody sitting out there with a blanket and their little kids and they're doing Wi-Fi with laptops right outside. And you know, there's another group sitting outside reading a book. So it was very, very convivial atmosphere there. So the grade was an A. The difference was the moment we walked in the door of the library, we went from a grade of an A to a grade of a D, consistently. Now that then started us to ask questions of why are we getting such a transformation when you walk from a beautiful place into suddenly a very dysfunctional place. Regardless of that, let me just say that the results of this presentation is going to show you what our ideas are and how we can combat that D. Because we know this works as an A. But when you walk inside the door, it's a B. The second piece that we found is that this book barn, although it's romantic in its setting, it really represents a tremendous accomplishment by the community to have a book barn, to have community sales, to share collections with your community members without having to go to Amazon and buy it on Amazon. Why can't you just buy it from the library, and it's a cheaper cost. And I absolutely, you know, these book fairs are just wonderful. And I just want to say one thing about it, something that just happened last week that I thought was really important to this book barn discussion. And that is that in the UK last week, this year, vinyl record sales have now beaten CD sales.
Whoa.
Yeah. I remember giving up my vinyl record collection when I left college. And I have collected records over the years for the very day to hear that statement. The same thing with books. Books aren't going away. So if we're talking about a library, we have two different types of books. One type is the print, and the other is what we call the volume equivalent, the digital. And there's lots of issues with the ebook. If you have a Kindle and it works, if you want to share lots of content with someone, a Kindle does work. But there is something different about opening up a book, and there's different sizes of books. But the most important piece to this is, again, although it looks nice, the conditions inside are unconditioned. It's not a great situation. I think in one of the reports I wrote that there are mice, there could be mice in there or possums or whatever. I mean, it's just unconditioned. Animals can get in, moisture can get in, heat can go up and down, and books really don't like to be treated without environmental conditions. Books don't respond well when you don't give them the right conditions. They get moldy, and then once you get mold in them, they're done. You gotta get rid of them. And so it's an asset when your community, when people in your community give to the library their books to be sold for possible or to be inclusion in the library, either way, it becomes a big issue. Because if you're not respecting the materials you're putting it into in a conditioned space, then you're wasting your time. And that's important to note because that's a big piece of the puzzle that we want to include, we want to solve here. Sure, there's Netflix. Every time I try to go on a Netflix and try to see a movie, I can't find it. So it's sort of the same thing. DVDs are still going to be around for how long, we don't know. That is a question. But the portability of DVDs is still a driver for the library. And lots of people make it an event to go to the library to pick out a couple of movies with their kids and to go home and watch them together. And so it's the same thing as the idea as the vinyl record sales. It's the idea that these are experiences. There's something different, although Netflix is very accessible and Amazon Prime and all these pieces are accessible, there is something special about doing things together, something community about doing things together. So the main driver today is the DVDs. The main circulation is the DVDs. Will that go away? That's a good question. We know books are not going to go away, so there's a big question. Will the DVDs go away in the next 5 years? Anybody think they're going away in the next 5 years?
No.
No? Okay.
Yes.
You got a yes. So there is a question out there. And I guess that plays into when you'll see the programming that's come back, how that plays out. I just love pictures like this. Because this picture just says to me, we don't have enough seats. And it says something else to me. It says to me, we don't have enough power. I'm sitting there because I need a plug. So I don't have a seat, but I have a plug. So I'm going to give up a seat to get a plug. But again, when we do the grades on this type of space, it's failing. In our grading system, we don't have any grade we usually stop at a D. So let's say this is somewhere around a D. I think she'd be a lot happier if she had a seat. I know I couldn't sit in that. I couldn't sit like that. So it does, for anybody who's older or has back problems, that's impossible for them. And so that's come out in the programming, which is the library is a little bit too small. And then I also just want to point out, this was the last slide that I did during the last presentation. It was sort of my kicker, it was my knockout punch when we're talking about the library. Because here's the story. I'll just give you back the story again. We're touring the library in the summertime here. Absolutely wonderful. I love my job, walking around libraries, seeing just people enjoying themselves, even under the circumstances that I've just shown you. She was still happy she had a plug. So it was still important. As I said, kids out front with their, reading in the garden and everything, and then Harvey says to me, "You want to see the cellar?" And I said, "Do I have to?" And he said, "I don't know. Maybe you should take a look." And I walked down the staircase, and I just went, "Ugh!" I said, "This is not what I wanted to find." So everything on the upper level of the library looked wonderful, looked beautiful, and then we went down the staircase, and it was just like, "Oh my God! There could be a fire at any point." You know, the electrical grid here is outdated. The water system isn't being treated properly. There are some significant issues here. And by the way, I have liability insurance. So as a consultant, I pay a lot of money for liability insurance. If I don't tell you that you have a problem, I can get sued. You have a problem. Okay? Done. Can't get sued now. But it's a short-term problem that triggers a larger term question. So we did a presentation, we called it Adopt Democracy. We'll do questions.
Yeah, you're standing in front of the screen.
I'm sorry, am I standing in front of the screen for everybody?
If you stand back a little bit, then okay.
Well, look at this. So we did Adopt Democracy, and we gave everybody dots, and in those dots, there was the green being the best, the red being second, and the red being third, and the yellow being second, that kind of thing. But if you see, and then things got kind of confused. We all got confused about what dots were really what. What we did know from the dotmocracy is, and I'm a pure believer that we don't try to control the community. The community controls itself. The community tells us what they see. And what we found is that this picture jumped out at us with all these dots on it, all these green dots on it, a lot more than any of the other ones. And I think it was because of the lettering. I don't personally like this interior design, so I don't know if it was the interior design, but I think it's the lettering. And so the lettering says dream. This community wants to dream, okay? Now at the same time, we also put out some exterior shots, and this got a couple of green spots. But we started to say, well, a what if? And I think it was important just to have that exercise. And I'm not going to go too far into that right now. Another thing we did is we did characterization exercises, and the characterization exercises help us visualize. So some people are very good verbalizing what they need. Other people are much better visualizing what they need through drawing. And so we started this technique, and it's been very effective in all the libraries we've worked on. Some really incredible ideas. But just look at this one person's, to be nameless. And by the way, that's part of our work here. There's no like, oh, Sally did a great job. This is a community project. Every one of you has a role to play. So, I mean, if you just look at it, some of the pieces that came out here, coffee cafe, musician performance area, archive, artist exhibition, seniors area, children's area, lecture area, political discussion, book club area. Some really interesting programmatic questions. And then another person took it a completely different way, and you know, the future, the history, performers, this whole idea of community sharing, a place for programming, a place for learning. I just love this picture. It's from New York State, one of the New York State things. But the main thing here is we're the community right now, and we've got the backpack on, and we started the hiking trail. And we started on the trail so far, and there have been ups and downs, but believe me, this is a long trail to go on. It's not very easy to get a plan going and to build consensus. And so in our future, we're gonna need R&D, which we're doing here. That's what really this is about, our research and development about what type of library the community needs. But we're also gonna, we also need you all to work and be morale boosters for each other about getting to this new library. And it may not be a new building, it may be some form of a building, but as I showed you just a second ago, when the foundation has water in it and the power is out of date, you're really talking about some change. And then I just want to say collaboration is the most important critical success factor. All of you working together within the community. So I talked a little bit about books. Let me just mention that the other piece that's going on here in library world is this idea of digital resources and access to digital resources. So I'll just explain it from my own business standpoint. My business, we used to have everyone come into the office 5 days a week. Everybody was in the office. Then what we got is we got a phone system called an IP phone system, which made it possible for my father to be in Florida, and me to be here, and my assistant to be in Rhinebeck. So, I'm in Croton, and I just hit the intercom, and they're there, okay? Then we took it one step further, and we started sharing a Dropbox. Now we share a Dropbox. The staff come into the office 2 days a week. The rest of the time, the staff is out there in the community looking for a place to work. I mean, they have their places, but it's a change in how we're working. And it's all because of how these tools and apps are possible. And in the library world, it gets really exciting because we get the opportunity to do online learning. And online learning is take an MIT course, take a course from Stanford, maybe they have something at Berkeley, maybe they have something at Cornell. You don't even need to go to Cornell to take the course. So you can do it right outside of your library. So at the same time you have the digital, we have to still remember that there's a balance between the digital and the print and the space that they require, okay? So to do digital work, we need user seating. We need people-centered people-focused types of spaces. So if we're going to have digital collections, access to courses around the world, video conferencing, you name it, whatever it is, high network. If you've got Google, you need a network. That's all digital. I don't need any space for that. I need seating space for that. But I can still stream the Wi-Fi outside. The book castle is an idea we came up with to confront an issue that we were trying to deal with libraries. So if you could imagine, if I'm going to come back to you and I have three variables, I have the collection, the user seating, and the staff. Well, if I need to increase the amount of user seating, then something else has got to change. I either need more collection space, or I need more user seat, or I need more staff space. So somewhere, and usually the staff space, we're going to be as efficient as possible. So it's really between the collection space and the staff space. So you could imagine, I would come back to a meeting like this, and I'd say to the community, well, you can have a brand new library, but guess what? I can only fit about half as many books into your library, so you're not going to be able to hold as many books. And you probably, and collectively, will probably start screaming back at me, really? Is that really what you're going to do? You're going to give us less books? You're going to give us less opportunity for learning? Less opportunity to give children the amount of books that will help them raise their literacy, those types of things? By the way, there's been studies, many studies over, the more books children have access to, the higher education they have access to. So, you know, this is a hard conversation for me to get up in front of you. So we developed a concept called the Book Castle, and it's in one of the programs. And the Book Castle is basically like this. It's an automated storage retrieval system. It's priced somewhere between $100,000 and $200,000. Maybe you'd have some additional cost associated with that over the years for maintenance. You probably have to pay, you know, over a 20-year span, let's say $100,000 you'd have to pay. But each year, over that 20-year span, maybe about $2,000 just in maintenance. It'd be like your generator. Your generator kind of works like when it trips over, it works, but then you also need a maintenance guy to come around to get your generator. I live in the woods, so when the power goes out, my wife, when we didn't have an automatic generator set up, my wife would have to go outside, she'd have to start up the generator, the gasoline would get in the house, all of that. That's the equivalent I call of the book barn you have now. It's an old barn, it just works the way it works, but you don't know how good it could be if you just had an automatic generator that just trips over. God, I couldn't even find a flashlight in my house the other day. We don't need them, because the lights don't go out anymore. We used to have times when the lights would go out for a week, but with the generator, it snaps right over. So it's a technology question. And then we get the bounce of this idea, this aesthetic of a book wall. And the book wall, this is a picture of the British Library. I corrected it from the first presentation. But the whole idea is if you walk into the British Library, you walk in and you see these beautiful books behind this glass, and all these people are studying around it, and they absolutely love it, because the books represent knowledge, and it doesn't really matter that they need access to those books. What matters is that they're in the right environment to learn. So, and then the last piece is that in order to store things in the most advanced way, we now have technology to store things vertically. And that's the secret to storage. The secret to storage is storing things vertically. And then it goes one step further. A typical bookshelf is 12 inches high. This has an efficiency button, so if I push the button, everything shrinks down to the amount of height that you need. And we can also do two things with the book castle. We can do one, we can store things by size to make it as efficient as possible, thereby storing even more collections. Or we can place collections in pallets that are serendipitous. So if I'm looking for something about Julius Caesar, I might find not just the book I'm looking for. So basically it goes like this. I request Julius Caesar from a librarian. She pushes a button. It comes out of the book castle. A tray of books comes out. And I could have all types of books about Julius Caesar. And so not only would I might just pick the one, I might pick five of them. The idea with the circulation is getting them out into the community. So, but the idea of the friends of the library, this book sales side of it is sustainability. This is income for the library. So let me give you two examples of income. The first is the Lancaster Public Library. Lancaster Public Library makes $100,000 a year on their book sale. What do they have that you don't?
More books.
Storage. That's it. Tompkins County, up here in Ithaca, $500,000 a year on book sales.
Wow.
You know what they have?
The university.
Storage.
A much higher storage.
Much larger population. I'm not saying, again, we could take all of these in isolation. All I'm saying is that the storage is really important to us as library planners. Because if you allow us to build storage into the building, then we provide you with the means to have a sustainable future. That's the point. And that's why we brought up the book castle. That's the idea. And I'm going to show you options that are with and without the book castle to show you the difference. Just some quick goals that we originally developed. First, consider the possibility of a building renovation, okay? And I mentioned the infrastructure being outdated. The second, generate support for a public building renovation plan by including community input. That's what today is about. We've done that at every step. You absolutely have to require your community feedback. You know, you want to ask your neighbors, find out, tell us more about what library we need, because this is the time, this is the once in generation time. Develop a building, a library that is big enough. Oh, here's a good one. Develop one that's big enough. How do we know it's big enough? I'm going to show you our calculations and how we got to that. And then four, offer more programs and meeting spaces. Now, I'm not going to go further than that, just keep going. And then finally, some other goals. Investigate parking, investigate flooding, too many trees, too many insects, poor water treatment strategies. Harvey's going to talk about that. Realign the entrance to assist the handicapped and reduce entry congestion. Again, back to that visual scan. Visual scan showed an A outside. It showed a D inside. If we upgrade the building to ADA standards to allow everyone access, with the existing configuration, we will have to reduce the amount of seating, collections, and staff space. Okay? Create a staff space plan. Your library director's office is now a meeting space and an accounting room and special collections room. It's not secure. The library staff are crawling all over each other in a very small processing space. It's amazing they do what they do. Rethink the children's space to offer more natural light, space for story time programs, events, and tutoring services. Right now, your story time room is on the upper floor. If a child who has disabilities can't get up there, if parents have to carry their kids up the stairs, what if somebody trips? What if somebody falls? How is this accessible? I'm not sure. And then create more space for nonfiction art and local artist shelving, which I absolutely love. I can't wait. Okay, so size. How do we know the size of the library is big enough? Well, there are no standards per se, but there are consultants like myself who have a heritage in library planning who know the answer, because we work on these questions all the time and we have certain guidelines that we use. In the past, library standards were based on the amount of books that you had, but this was departed about 15 years ago when I started my career doing library planning. So in my whole career, it transferred from books being the driver to being people space being the driver. So the collections used to be the driver, now it's the user seating. And the staff space was always about the same. It's always about 15% of the total net assignable square footage. So the population here, I'm just rounding up numbers. We've seen numbers 5,800, 6,100, whatever it is, it's around 6,000. That's your local population. And the summer population rises to about 9,500. I can tell you I was here in the summertime, it looked like it was more than that. And there was a bit of traffic too, and it was impossible to park. So, you know, 9,000, I think it's more like 12. But let's be conservative. Let's say it grows to a couple of thousand in the summertime. We usually like to use 1 square foot per capita, but really the required square foot per capita that would give you this flexibility should be around 2. I'll describe it a different way, and we're all kind of New Yorkers here. It's kind of a New York joke, but when we look at libraries on the East Coast, we kind of balance them between the New Jersey standard and the Massachusetts standard, okay? The Massachusetts standard is 2 square foot per capita. And if you've ever been to a nice town around Boston, which I have, we recently worked on a Boxford Public Library just north of Boston. Wonderful historic community, really nice people, but really historic, and just you felt like you were in New England. There are two square foot per capita. If you're in New Jersey, you're at 0.7 per capita. You're at 0.5 per capita. You're whatever Chris Christie wants to give you, as long as it's in. just take a drive around, and you'll see that in general, their libraries are very small and underserved. And so, you know, I always look for opportunities to help people in New Jersey. But as far as standards are concerned, in New York, we have to decide whether we want to be more like New Jersey or more like Massachusetts. And I can't see your community fits into the New Jersey model. Unless you're going to be really close to Princeton and that island there. So that's where we are. So when we look at the space, you're about 12,000 with traditional shelving. So take the book castle out. Say the consultant's coming in, he's got crazy ideas about technology. We're Woodstock, we don't need technology. We just want to put it the old-fashioned way. We want to put the book stacks in there. If you want to do it the old-fashioned way, you're going to need about 12,000 net assignable square feet. And you're going to see that rolls out to about 15,000 gross square feet, depending on how you bring that net. So we all do our taxes. We all know when we get our salary from our company, we get our salary and we see all the pieces that come out. So somebody says, oh, you got a new job. You make $60,000 a year. Guess what? You got to take out for Social Security. You got to take out for who knows what other tax. That's the net assignable. It's the actual square footage that you need. So we start with the square footage that you need. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a couple of bubble diagrams to kind of illustrate the building program. Okay? So the first is the total square footage. This is your total square footage of your library now. Okay? This is the gross square feet. Okay? This is everything you have. This is your salary. And the population is about 6,000, I said. So let's unpeel it a little bit. We have a book barn I put in the back there. That's about 1,780 square feet, unconditioned. It's not really a library space. So that 7,000 is really not 7,000. It's less than 7,000. I do the math in a second. And then, not only is the 7,000 in the book barn unconditioned, but as I just mentioned, the second floor is really inaccessible, and it's a problem waiting to blow up, basically. And that's about 725 square feet. So now, if you put the two together, your actual gross square feet is 4,000. You're New Jersey. You know? Seriously. This is so, the library's too small. We're not sitting here because you have a big library and I'm trying to sell you something you don't need. And, you know, so anyway, just to see, this is your library, and I'm going to show you in a second some of the programmatic pieces. But, you know, that's basically how the library kind of lays out. And then I have, let me just go to this. So I have three different types of programs here. The first is the book castle concept. And I just want to bring you back to the three variables. Because if you can get your head around the three variables, then planning for this library is really easy, right? So the first is that if we're looking at that ideal library, a 10,000 square foot program that kind of rolls up into a 15,000 square foot library, which, by the way, 15,000 square feet is about the size that you can fit on this site. You really can't fit much more. Then you're gonna, if we do the book castle, you're gonna get 198 seats. You have 91 right now. So that means we're gonna double the amount of seats, plus. And what does that equate into? That equates into programming space, larger children's discovery space, maker space. It turns into real things, real spaces for people. Here's another piece to it. 72, my number just one extra zero, but it's 72,224. So that's 72,000 books. Right now you're holding about 43,000. You have the capacity to hold. So what I'm also saying to you is, I want to give you a cake and eat it too. I don't just want to give you more seats. I want to give you more collections too. I want to make you more sustainable than less. So that's what the book castle is about. Now, if we just unpeel that a little bit, if we do compact shelving, which is a traditional way of doing it, and Harvey just builds us a new book barn, and we put compact shelving in there, we'll spend about the same amount of money, and we'll get a little less, so we're still going to be able to increase your collection, that's good, so that's positive, but we won't hit those 200 seats. We'll lose probably either between the Storytime makerspace or your local art exhibition space, depending on how you decide what you want to do with your program spaces. So you start to lose it. And then if we just go with a traditional, a traditional library design with traditional shelving, the seating gets squeezed down to 100 and 129. So that's going from 91 to 129 if you go in the traditional way. So if you choose to just go with traditional storage, you're going to get more seats, but you're only going to get one more meeting room. And if this plan is going to last for the next 50 years, I don't think one meeting room is going to do it. And so that's why we brought up the book castle. We didn't bring up the book castle to try to sell you some new great idea. We're just looking at the numbers and we're trying to give you more. And if we can hit 200 seats in a 15,000 square foot building, here's another interesting piece to this puzzle that you wouldn't know, that I know, that I work with all the time, which is our model is a 25,000 square foot building. That's our model. I've had it for years. And we call up the library, library in Indiana. Oh, okay, 25,000 square foot library? Okay, I got a program for that. Let's meet the people, find out what about. The difference between a 25,000 square foot library and a 15,000 square foot library is storage. That's all. That's really the difference. Or the difference between a 25,000 square foot library and a 15,000 square foot library is a meeting space, a program space. And the driver here is to have more meeting spaces. So with the book castle, you can see that we still are gonna have display collections. All these little bubbles represent a display collection, a collection you can browse around. I'm not talking about putting a book castle in and getting rid of all the books. On the contrary, I'm talking about giving you a repository and then providing you with places that you can still browse and experience those collections without trying to stuff everything in to one closet. A couple of other interesting pieces. So the Friends would use the book castle also, as I mentioned. So the book castle is an investment in the sustainability model to be able to ingest collections from the community over the year and sell them during the festival. You still have the idea of the front lawn, and we thought about having teen spaces, group spaces, a no-tech space. We thought about having media spaces, so still having spaces. And as a matter of fact, in our programming, you're showing right now about 300 linear feet of media collections. We're looking at putting it over 1,000. So you think your DVD browsing experience is good now? I'm going to quadruple it. But I can only do that with certain, by taking certain pieces. It's like a domino effect with programming. So once we pull out one piece. So again, a local history space that you can go into, a rare book room that you don't have. And you have some really cool artists here. So this is a place that really could showcase. Think of it as a showcase. Now let's say we put it into compact shelving. If we put it into compact shelving, the story time room gets smaller. A lot of the local art exhibition space goes away. There's no more of that. We don't have space for exhibitions and galleries and art. I mean, we've got to put as many books in as we can, right? So there's a children's area. We still keep you, we give you a program space. So you do have a large program space. And that program space can be changed. So combat shielding isn't that far off. It just, that extra 30 seats is that extra meeting space that you might not have, or that extra group, couple of group study spaces that you wish you had if you had thought about developing the library. And just in the numbers standpoint, just looking at the numbers, you know, the book castle represents about 3,000 square feet for the friends and the collection. And that's all it is. It's just to try to store things better on site. It's not some newfangled trick or something like that. It's just if we do that, then that story time room, you see that little bubble there which says story time room, that's all I can fit if I don't have that. Once you do that, the story time room becomes a makerspace discovery center, which then triggers a small business, you know what I mean, and tutoring space. So it becomes a whole nother discussion. So just bring me back to reality before I depart on my, I'm gonna give you just a couple more slides and then Harvey's gonna take over. But this is where you are today. You're at unconditioned space. You're at a low-end library for a great community, which is really just unacceptable. So if you're angry, you have every right to be, but take that anger and use it to develop the next generation library. So let me just show you a concept. This is just a general concept. It has nothing to do with your library. But the idea is just to have a couple of these seating elements in. So a couple of seating elements are, first is it's called the living edge, and those are the seating along the wall. The living edge is the quiet or reflective space. You need to have a big enough library so that you have reflective seating, a place for focus, a place to study, a place to work without being disturbed. The second is, if you can see in the two corners, there's collaboration spaces. Collaboration spaces are meeting with your friends, working in parallel, getting together to discuss a topic, book clubs, book studies. It's just endless. It's endless how many types of group meetings you can have. Knitting groups. I absolutely love the knitting group that's here. And then, as I mentioned, when we're talking about book castle or whatever, we're not talking about taking the bookshelves out. We're still going to have bookshelves in it, but they're not the focal point. The focal point is the center of the room. The center of the room is flexible. The center of the room has to change depending on what's going on. So say in the morning, the seniors get together for their coffee break, they're reading the papers. In the afternoon, you have a couple of schools come in, the school children come in, and they have a story time in the library. And then in the evening, you have one of your artists give a lecture to a whole community. And it's changing that space. And believe it, I've been showing this diagram a good 5 years now, and now the architects are saying to me, we're doing it. So the time has come for flexible spaces. And everything can be on wheels. Everything can be deassembled. And then, so you go from that event where you have a famous author speak, or artists come in, or local artists speak, whatever, however it gets defined. And then it goes back to being a library. And it sits there as a library. And so it changes as it's needed. And that's what a modern building gives you. Modern building gives you the storage, so you can be sustainable. And so you can have more collections, not less. The seating, so you can have reflective seating. You can have collaborative seating, group study seating. You can have presentations. You can have touch points where people can have conversations with library staff. Research questions can be answered. Historical research, all of that. And the last one, which is the most challenging, and you can't do unless you have the right size library, is you want it to be a social space. A place where people can have conversations without disrupting the people who want to quietly research and focus on things. So that's my section. I'm going to give it over to Harvey.
I wonder if that's on. You might have to turn it on.
Hello?
Again. Yeah, it's on.
It's on. Okay. Everybody can hear me okay? I'm at the right position. So Alex has presented a lot of information, a lot that you need to mull over, you need to think about, a lot of new concepts. I'm going to try to show you how this all will fit into your site. Just reset this time. Try to stay on schedule.
We'll try it and see.
Okay, good. All right. So again, just to reiterate, so first of all, let me start out with some of the how I analyzed this and how we did this. Starting with certain assumptions that we made. All the concepts I'm going to be presenting today are compared to the 15,000 square foot ideal program that Alex presented. This is 15,000 square foot gross, so you have to take the square footages that Alex presented, think of them in gross, because that's what actually is going to get built onto the site. Either program, if you think of Alex's presented two or three programs here, one with the book castle and one without the book castle, either one will work to a greater or lesser extent with the 15,000 square feet. So everything I'm presenting is 15,000 square feet, or attempting to reach the 15,000 square feet, and it's tested against those programs. And deciding which program fits into the building is, in a sense, a parallel, separate decision. The second assumption that we made is that we're limiting all the new construction we're showing on the site is two stories. We decide on two stories for a few reasons. One story just doesn't give you enough space. It's a very small area, very small footprint that you can build on. Two stories seems about right. Can get you, in several of the concepts, will get you to the 15,000 square feet. So we're thinking two stories, possibly with a three-story tower. If we go with the book castle concept, you probably may also need mechanical equipment, the elevator equipment, mechanical equipment on the roof. So there's a possible three-story part to it, but basically two stories of building. Three stories we rejected for, doesn't meet the zoning code, it doesn't really fit in with the context of Woodstock, and the other possibility we briefly looked at, can we go down a third, down one floor, create three stories? Again, it's not a possibility on the site given all the water problems. So two stories is what we fixed on. We also made the assumption the library would be able to obtain whatever zoning variances that it might need. Many of the schemes that I have, many of the concepts I came up with don't really require any zoning variances. To the extent that it does, we've kept where we violate setback requirements, we've violated them only to the extent that the current building violates them. So in other words, we're using the sort of grandfathered clause to say, okay, we're not making it any worse than it is currently. Also, we feel that as a public institution, the library would be likely, would be allowed whatever zoning variances from the town. That would get a sympathetic hearing towards any kind of hardship appeals. Finally, we looked briefly at the 6 Library Lane site. We don't feel that, given the size of the site, the shape of the site, once you superimpose the setbacks, the wetlands requirements, restrictions, it doesn't leave much of a footprint, and it's not a very useful site for any kind of real building. Likely good for. I'll take questions after this. It's likely possible. You know, so it seems to be mostly useful for perhaps a park setting, a pavilion, possibly a small building for Friends of the Library if that gets if it's found that it's needed. Those are the basic assumptions. I also want to look at the new point out the advantages of new construction. All these concepts are tested against new construction. New construction offers several advantages, some of which Alex hit upon. It's more flexible, open space. That's a big advantage. With new construction, you're going to have better environmental quality, better indoor environmental quality. And people talk about indoor air quality, well, that's important. I like to talk about indoor environmental quality because it's the air quality, it's the light. With the new building, you can configure for better natural light. To the extent that you need artificial light, you can use the best quality artificial light, and also good acoustics. So it's really indoor environmental quality in general that's important about new construction. New construction provides state-of-the-art energy conservation, the possibility of sustainable green design, and that would include the possibility of solar, providing for resilient design, a building that can remain habitable in case it's ever cut off from the grid, which is an asset to the, as a public building, it would be an asset to your community. And also, this seems to be more advantageous financing in terms of bonds, Class A. A new Class A building can be bonded, financed over a longer period, allowing for smaller payments, lower costs to the taxpayers, and I think that's calculated on the green sheets that you have that you can look at afterwards. So let's get into the various concepts. The first concept that I came up with, concept number one, is essentially a baseline concept. Renovate the current building without any significant expansion. That's the plan of your current building. Just to orient you, Tinker Street goes along the bottom, Library Lane going north and south. The 5 Library Lane site is off to the right, Library Lawn in the front.
6.
Existing building and the book barn in the back to the north. The idea in concept one is that we are providing, and there are, these are around, if you want to look at these, this is a physical conditions report that I created. We looked at the building, we have a whole list of what I call action items and more difficult items. The costing that we that I'm going to present to you, the approach is to try to take care of all the items to that we possibly can to bring the building up to for good standards, good usable standards. Taking care of all action items and all of the so-called more difficult items. I'm not going to go through the whole list, but some of the main things to realize is we would, in order to provide full ADA access throughout the building, we would propose we would take out all the existing shelves, all existing furniture, new shelves, new furniture. The shelving layout would have to change to provide the 3-foot aisles necessary. And you'll see how that impacts the existing building. We relocate the mechanical equipment from that flooded cellar, get the electric panels out of there, rewire the building, upgrade the electrical system. In concept one, we would not be looking at a new book castle. So the other concepts, that's an option. In concept one, we would not be doing the book castle at all. So looking at some of the numbers here, again, the areas are all calculated as gross square feet. The first number I have here is what I calculated as the existing fully usable space. That is, that's the ground floor library that you have now. It's the only part of the library that you can really consider year-round usable, accessible space. Totals at 5,210 square feet. That's only about a third of the 15,000 square foot ideal program that we're proposing. If you add in the existing second floor, which is not currently ADA accessible, that adds another 900 square feet. If you add the existing book barn, which is unconditioned space, it's about 2,000 square feet. You have a total of about 8,000 square foot, again, of which more than a third is not currently usable in the current configuration. To change that, what we would propose are cost of our concept one, this cost of the renovation of the existing building. To fully renovate the existing usable square foot, that's the first floor of the library again. All new shelves, mechanical equipment, again, everything, design fees, we're looking at $900,000. All the costs I present, by the way, are including design fees, all the furniture and fixtures, as well as an appropriate contingency. Because in the case of a renovation, you don't know what you're going to run into, so there is a contingency factor added in there. If you decide to install an elevator tower, I say if feasible, it would be a difficult problem. But the only way that I can see to get access to the second floor, you don't really have a floor area within the building, you somehow have to build an elevator tower on the outside of the building. We're budgeting a number of an additional 280,000 square feet to make that second floor, that small second floor, accessible.
Dollars.
Yes, $280,000. Not square feet. We also looked at trying to renovate the book barn to make it a year-round space. That would be a very difficult problem. You have to, you know, everything from raising the floor, re-insulating the envelope, you really have to put in more windows, skylights, the light in there is terrible. Again, that would require a lot more investigation, but we're budgeting a number of about, just so for planning purposes, 570,000 square feet. I'm sorry, $570,000, forgive me. $570,000 to try to make that a functional year-round space, and that's a very rough budget number. So, totaling all that up, you have a total cost of $1.75 million, about $215 per square foot, just to renovate what you have, and probably not a good bargain, but I'll get to that in a minute. But look at some pros and cons here. Obviously, the pros of concept number one, maintains the front lawn, keeps the familiar building and historic L in place, and will keep the book barn as well. On the negative side of the ledger, it only provides, even with all that renovation, the 8,000 square feet only provides just about, maybe slightly over 50% of the ideal program, half the ideal program. In order to accommodate the ADA access, again, requiring taking out all the shelving, all the seating, reconfiguring the library to give you the 3-foot aisles, the turning radiuses that are required, the total linear feet of shelving in the end is going to be reduced. That means, to put it in other terms, you would be spending $1.75 million completely renovating your library. You're going to have less shelving, likely less seating than you currently have in order to meet the current ADA codes. Not really a good deal. End result would be less than what you have now. There would be no new space, none of the new flexible space, none of the qualities of new space that you would probably want. Probably you would only have one public restroom. It would be ADA accessible. No children's restroom. There may be options that work there, but again, it becomes a trade-off. There's so little space involved. In order to get a second restroom, you're going to get less space. We wouldn't plan for any real upgrade to the staff areas. and there was no increase. I mean, it'd be upgraded in terms of quality, but no increase in area. You would still have your old building maintenance issues. Important to note that my renovation costs, I don't include any numbers for a new roof. The roof you have is probably about halfway through its useful life. You have another 10, 15 years on it. So that cost is not even involved. So that's a cost that's going to come up down the road. It's a very complicated roof, a lot of different slopes. That's an ongoing maintenance problem. Other than a few areas of specific repairs, we're not really including any kind of new roof. Operational downtime, all these concepts, I'm giving an operational, what that means is the period of time that you're going to be without your library building during renovation and construction. In this case, you have to vacate the building for probably about a year before you can get to your new library.
I have a clarification question, if I may. So for the $1.75 million, none of that includes fixing the beams?
No questions.
Yeah, I think, let's do it at the end.
If you have any questions, write them down on your cards.
Yeah.
It would be really helpful. Because we're running out of time.
So
we're running out of time. This is the most important. This is the council member. And okay. Write down the questions.
Please.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Write down the questions.
Keep going.
Okay. All right. So, looking at concept number two. In this concept, we have a new addition to replace the barn in the rear and upgrades to the building that remains. So, again, this is something that I think has been reviewed, the community's familiar with. We have, we would take down the existing barn structure, build as much as we can in the back. We would provide a small connector between the elevator tower and the existing to try to capture that second floor space. And we have a few views here, what that would probably look like from eye level. These are all very conceptual ideas. These aren't architectural designs. But this gives you some idea of what this addition would look like behind the existing building. We have an aerial view here. This PowerPoint will be available, I understand, online for study in going forward. So looking at the numbers on this, we have, we calculate that the new addition would be about 6,350 square feet. The existing to remain is 6,110 square feet. That's the existing plus the second floor that is now accessible. Gives you a total of 12,460 square feet. Cost-wise, we think that we budget for the new addition $3.25 million. In this case, that includes, in addition to everything I mentioned before, it includes the includes the cost of demolition, renovation of existing, probably about 850,000 square feet. That number is slightly smaller because it would share mechanical systems and so forth. Total cost of $4.1 million, about $330 per square foot. That's averaged over the renovation and the new together. Pros of concept number two, again, maintains the front lawn, keeps the familiar building and historic center in place. Cons, it only provides about 83% of the ideal program. Only about 50% of the square footage would be new with all the qualities that new would provide. And the old building maintenance issues remain. We're calculating a downtime of about 9 months. We think that the existing library could operate for some time, but at some point it would have to be closed down to finish the work, finish the renovation, connect the two buildings. Since the presentation I did to the board on the 19th, we've added a concept 2A. This was something I thought was important to investigate. This is we're providing for a larger area of new construction at the rear. Larger area of new construction in the rear, replacing most of the existing building. We would only keep, in this concept, only keep the 1967 main building, that's the familiar entrance that everybody knows, and the historic L. Now, this concept is, I think, fraught with problems in many ways. Architecturally, what's left of the existing library gets very lost behind this rather large two-story addition. There are ways we've tried to moderate this in terms of massing. There are probably other ways that we could investigate to step it down and so forth. There's also technical problems involved. You're taking out so much of your existing building, you'd have to shore up what remains. And you'll see that the costing reflects the fact that this would be a difficult project to execute. And another view here of what it would look like, the kind of bird's eye view. Rather large building engulfing what's left of what's existing. But we thought it was worth at least taking a look at. We think we can get a new addition of 12,230 square feet, leaving 2,770 square feet remaining, getting you just to the total of 15,000 square foot, which is the 15,000 square foot ideal program. 82% of that 15,000 square foot would be new space. Costs. The new addition, again, these are budget numbers. Given all the complications working around what's there, we've budgeted $5.4 million for this. Obviously, there's much less square footage of existing to be renovated, 350,000 square feet for a total cost of $5.75 million, about $385 per square foot. Pros and cons. Does provide, probably we could get 100% of your ideal program, maintains the front lawn, maintains the familiar facade, and the historic L. And in terms of cons, you still have some old building maintenance issues, and we're calculating operational downtime of probably 18 months, since most of the existing library is lost. And you really have to vacate the building during this construction period. Concept number three is probably the most radical, and so I'm going to take a little bit of time to explain it because I think it's worthy. This is the new building on Tinker Street in the front, and then maintaining the existing building in its entirety with a kind of a courtyard, essentially a lawn in between the two structures. We looked at this problem this way as a kind of a campus situation. What would happen if we built an entirely new separate building and think of it as a campus with different functions in different buildings? The new building, I've sited the new building as far forward as possible to maintain as much lawn as possible between the new and the existing. The new building meets all the legal setback requirements on Tinker Street. I want to explain it this way. It maintains the built context of Woodstock, the village of Woodstock. In other words, if you're coming from the east, all the buildings along Tinker Street are relatively close to the sidewalk, creating kind of a pedestrian scale, walkable town. This building would continue essentially that line, provide a kind of a bookend, if you'll forgive the pun, as the sort of termination of the pedestrian, of the sort of more commercial portion of the village, after which, going to the west, they built the houses and so forth, start to set back more into a more residential arrangement. So that's the overall planning perspective. This view tries to give you an idea of what you would have. You'd have the existing library remaining in its entirety. You'd have the new building off to the left there. You have a sort of a, as I said, a courtyard lawn in between the two of them. They're connected in the back. On the west side of the site, we're connecting the two with an art walk. Again, it's a possibility at this point. Art walk being essentially a walkway that you could use to display the art collections. It could be completely closed to display artwork. It could be an open, just kind of arcade. It could be something in between with windows that are closed during the inclement weather, during wintertime, opened up in the summertime. And we have a sort of a more aerial view that will give you a sense of how the complex would work. Now this gives you a variation. There's some variations relative to this as well. You can see the existing library is maintained in its entirety. Functionally, how would this work? Well, there's all sorts of ways you could do that. One possibility is you could use the existing library perhaps as the children's library. That has a certain functional logic to that, since there's a separate children's librarian, so it keeps your staffing the same. So that becomes the children's library. Another possibility is the existing library could become the quiet, low-tech, Wi-Fi free zone for users who prefer that type of space. It would also make people concerned about their children having exposed to Wi-Fi. There's a certain logic to group those services together. It also maintains the book barn. Friends of the library still have their book barn to use to do their book sales. You may find, though, that once the new building is built, you'll have enough extra space left over in the existing building such that Friends of the Library could offset their services into the conditioned space of the existing library, giving you yet another option. That is, you could, when this is all done, take down the book barn, provide existing parking in the back. This campus idea helps a lot with the phasing. It helps a lot. It solves a lot of problems and gives a lot of options. So, analyzing this new addition, or the new building, really would be about 10,000. We would probably get about what we've shown is 10,000 square feet. There'd be 5,210 square foot of existing to remain. Second floor, in this case, would not really be accessible. We could still use it, but we wouldn't try to put an elevator in. A total of 15,210 square feet, of which two-thirds is new, flexible space with all the advantages of the new space, the interior environmental conditions, so forth. We've not included the unconditioned barn in any of these above totals, so that square footage remains in addition to what we're proposing to build under Concept 3. Cost of Concept 3. Because it's a freestanding building, and we've analyzed this carefully, I've gone back over these numbers many times, I think that the existing building, the new addition, can be built for we're estimating $3.6 billion all in. If you add in the renovation of the existing at the $900,000 that we've used before, total cost of about $4.5 million, $295 per square foot. So that's, again, averaged out over the new and renovation of existing. Pros and cons. The Concept 3 provides 100% of the ideal program that we're proposing. It keeps the familiar and cherished building in place. The book barn remains if the parking option isn't used. And there's very limited disruption of library services. In other words, the existing library can remain operating while you're building the new library. Once the new library is built, you can offset your collections from the old library to new library, keep operating the new library while the old library is renovated. So there's very little downtime in there. It makes for a very, very easy staging, if you will. Cons, obviously, the biggest con, everyone knows, you would lose about half of your front lawn. That would be what you would have to sacrifice for this Concept 3. And you would still have some old building maintenance issues because you still have the old building you need to maintain. Anyway, presented for your consideration. Concept 4. Finally, we get to the fourth concept or fifth concept, depending on how you're counting here, which is demolish the existing building entirely, replace it with an entirely new building. We've cited this with generally utilizing the setbacks. I think we've used maybe the grandfathered setbacks towards the back, and this is just conceptual. You can't look at this as any kind of finished design. One thing to realize about this is the costing and the analysis that we've done on this new design is transportable, so to speak. If you were able to locate a new site somewhere within the village, you can use the cost factors for this new library, which includes demolition. So you can take these same costs, move it to another site. You might be able to deduct demolition costs. You might need to add land acquisition costs. But you can use this as a kind of a baseline if you were able to find another site, and you would be able to keep the existing library during the construction. This is an idea, again, just a concept, what the building would look like. The entrance could be, we're showing the entrance here on Library Lane. We're trying to open it up with a kind of a porch towards the library lawn, towards the south. This is just to give you an idea of the size. Design could be really almost anything. This is an aerial view of what this concept would look like. Analyzing this, I'm about to wrap up so let's look at some numbers here. So in analyzing concept number 4, we're talking about a totally new building of 15,000 square feet. We're talking about 100% new space with all the advantages that we previously spoke of on new space. We estimate the new building would be, including demolition costs, everything, $5.75 million, about $380 per square foot. Looking at the pros. It provides 100% of the ideal program and 100% new space. It does maintain the front lawn. The cons, you would lose the existing buildings. And we're estimating that the operational downtime, the time that you wouldn't have a library, would be about 18 months to a year. 2 years, I'm sorry, 18 months to 2 years. Glad that somebody can read here. So, wrapping up here, this is an admittedly very simplistic summary. And I realize I'm not going to try to pretend this captures all the very, and this community, you have a lot of different factors to look at, a lot of ways to, other things that need to be considered, but this is just trying to put everything onto one summary slide here. You've got concept number 1, which I think you would end up with less than you currently have, improved facilities, but less linear feet of shelving, probably less seating, for $1.75 million. Concept 2 would be an improvement, but not the full program, for $4.1 million. Concept 2A gives you the full program, but less than ideal space, lots of problems with the project for $5.75 million. You can see where that cost is probably not a good deal. Concept 3, full program with more ideal space for $4.5 million. That's the courtyard scheme that I presented. Concept 4, full program, 100% new space, again, for the $5.75 million. And now we have time for questions. It's up to you. Ask the questions, discuss the options, and let's get to work to get the library that you guys, that Woodstock deserves.
Ask the question.
Thank you.
Question and answers, comments in two sections. Fortunately, we have lots of good questions here. We want to get through as many of them as possible. We also have a speaker's sign-up sheet. There will be a microphone for those who would prefer to ask their question orally. But let me get started with a few of these. What happens to the library staff during the downtime? Are they laid off? That was one.
That's a question. Well, I don't think so. I think that's a question for the library board. I think the intent would be to get 10%.
So the library staff will continue to run the library. Many libraries have gone through this type of process of renewal. What will happen is, depending on the option that you choose, will depend on how long the actual library is closed. But the library can still run out of a trailer, or it can run out of bread alone if you make a connection. And it actually, I look at it as an opportunity, because when you close the library, that's an opportunity for the library staff to look at different ways of how they can work with the community.
One question was, what's a historic L? And maybe I can answer that. That's this small little section off to the left of the main library where you walk in. Little stars are across the frieze. That was built as an addition for a doctor's office back in 1812. And that is the most historic portion of the building. Regarding concept 4, what is the cost of temporary space during renovation? Any thought to that?
I think we estimated $100,000 for a year's worth of temporary space, including the move out, move back. That's a very soft number. And that's why we indicated the downtimes for all of these concepts. Again, concept 3 being the least amount of downtime, concept 4 being the greatest amount of downtime.
In comparing the different concepts, has anyone estimated the annual maintenance and staff costs for each concept? And i.e., they want to know, would the book tower castle concept require additional staff?
Sure. So the difference, what we did is we programmed staff space at six full-time staff members. So we based it off of your existing staff count. So that's how the program is built. And you have a number of volunteers that are going to be working that work in the library, that are going to continue to work in the library. So if you do choose to go with one of the storage systems like the Book Castle, then it will be a closed stack system. So instead of the volunteers or the student workers reshelving books, what they'll be doing is they'll be working on the data between the actual collection and the storage grain silo thing, as opposed to reshelving books. So in some respects, you can look at the staff. This is the next generation for the staff to actually do analysis on the collection as opposed to just reshelving things where they are. So it's much more of a good data question. A lot of people ask us when we do libraries, they try to ask us questions about how is the collection being used. It's pretty hard to know how the collection is being used except for using the circulation data, and the circulation data may or may not be the collections that are on the shelves, or a collection could be reshelved in the wrong place and you would never know where it is. So the Book Castle does a lot of things. It allows you to add a layer of data onto your collection, which allows you then, as I was saying, if you're looking 50 years into the future, each piece of collection, especially the local writers, the specialty items that you have here that is nowhere else, you can add metadata to that. So a lot of our work these days as librarians is adding metadata to the actual collections you have. So it's a real opportunity.
There's a number of questions about Book Castles.
Can I follow up on that? That was my question. You didn't answer the book part.
You didn't answer the anyone maintenance
going for the different concepts.
Sure, and we've talked with the vendors about maintenance. And the vendor basically said to me that, you know, it's about $2,000 a year to run the maintenance on the system. They install these types of systems in hospitals, for e-commerce, for pharmaceutical companies, for jewelry, people who make jewelry, for automotive supplies, and for aeronautics. And one of the questions that was a follow-up to that one is, what if the thing breaks down? Well, you could imagine a hospital that has one of these systems. It can't break down for very long. So that's part of a maintenance agreement. So our estimate is it will cost you about $100,000 for 20 years worth of maintenance, which is about $2,000 a year.
So. Alex, people want to know if there's a Book Castle currently in existence, and how can people browse with a Book Castle? How does that work?
So the storage system is not new, but it's being used, it's brand new for the library world. We do have a library, a new building, that is putting in a Book Castle for Tri-County Technical College in Pendleton, South Carolina. It's a feeder school to Clemson. And the reason why that they're building this school is because they opened up a new BMW plant near there, and they need to upgrade their workers. And so when they came back to us with the new building plan for the new Student Success Center, this is a shared, between four counties approved this project. So it's a shared facility. And when we saw the first plans come back, the library was mainly books, and there weren't enough seats for students to do research, to do learning, collaboration, all the elements I focused on before. So it became obvious once we used the Book Castle as a storage repository, we were able to have less collections on the floor plate. Now that doesn't mean no collections. On the contrary, it's more like having display collections that you can browse. So we're still gonna have browsable collections. It's just that in your fiction room, your non-fiction room, your fiction room, you're not gonna have the long shelves of browsing. You're gonna have shorter areas that you can browse around. You can turn books out, you can merchandise them, you can have staff picks, you can have rare books, you can have local artists. So you can focus your collection as opposed to trying, I almost describe it as mom and pop shop. You know, try to get everything under one roof. It's pretty hard. This gives you that repository with that. So the browsing, the idea is not to take the browsing away. And the idea is futuristic because we want this project to last the next 50 years.
So the answer is that there's no current library using this system?
Correct. There is a building that is being built as we speak, and there's a webcam going up about it, and the same people ask the same questions you asked. Do they want to be the first on the block to get it? And it's a struggle. But when you look at the program,
there are a number of, I think 20 installations across the country now. Typically, I think what you're saying is this is new for smaller libraries, and has
correct.
Been used quite successfully, I believe, in some larger libraries.
You're absolutely right. It has been used. Storage repositories have been used for large libraries for many, many years, and we worked on them for the University of Maryland. But that's how we learned about the Boatcastle, because we're working on small library projects at the same time, and we're trying to think, how can we solve that problem too?
Here's the one who wants to know how the process is going to end up with the final decision, and as to which concept will be chosen, and where do I cast my vote? Does my vote matter? Yes, we definitely want to hear all of your ideas about which of these concepts make the most sense. On the green sheets that were handed out on the back, you'll see there's an email address that's been established, masterplan@woodstock.org, so you can shoot it in there, and we'll make sure that all the board members see that. So I guess I answered that one.
Okay. I think that also Alex and I are going to be, the library will be forwarding any questions to us, any follow-up questions in the form of emails. So we'll be answering questions online for you.
With the increase of more square footage and more people using the library, will there be an issue with parking and ingress and egress of Library Lane? Will Library Lane turn into a one-way street?
I will say this. You have some opportunities with the current site. There is a parking lot across the street, and we walked it. It is a little bit of a ways, and so there would have to be a traffic pattern to slow traffic down and to create a walkway where the hardware store is. But that's good. I mean, creating a pedestrian community is really a good thing. So you have parking nearby. I do agree that parking is always an issue. Every library project I work on, parking's an issue. I was doing a library in New York City. Parking was an issue. I mean, I still to this day don't understand that one. But so we always will have parking as a challenge. The idea is that we want to create a campus-like atmosphere so that it's pedestrian-wide. So we really don't want to push cars close to the building if we can.
Just to be a little more specific, so people know what we're talking about, I think you're referring to there's a lot off of Camo Drive that's a public lot, and that seems to be underutilized.
Yeah, I can add your answer, if I may. If I can add your answer.
Yeah.
I am on the town board, and I am actively working on the crosswalk. So I'm already been in contact with New York State DOT, and we are working on getting a crosswalk there to formalize the pathway. So that work has started.
Nice. Good job.
What is compact shelving? Is that what we have now?
No. Compact shelving is a traditional way that we put collections in a repository. Compact shelving is basically I take the aisles away from the, so it's like an accordion. I take the aisles away from the storage unit. So as opposed to being able to walk through, you have to wind up these shelves, and these shelves open up like an accordion. And as I stated earlier, I've been working on libraries for 16 years now, and up until this last year, with the Bookcastle concept, we would normally recommend compact shelving if we wanted to compress collections. So we get basically a 2-to-1 ratio on storage per a 7 shelves traditional. So 7 shelves high is what you have, it's traditional, double-faced, right, either side. With compact shelving, I take away the aisle spacing and I just compress them. And the problem with it is, if more than one person wants to do research, you have to wait. So it's the same issue as the Bookcastle. You're going to have to wait to get into it or use it. So it's just a different storage mechanism. But it is a mechanism to compress the amount of space and put the most amount of collections in a very confined site.
So on movable, another question came up about movable walls or shelving. That's not sound, allows for soundproof. Or maybe, I'm sorry, movable walls are not soundproof. How will our current writing workshops function without real doors?
Yes, so what we want to do is we want to overlay this future plan on what we call the five modes of learning. And the five modes of learning are social, collaborative, presentation, touch point, and reflective. Now, most libraries make the mistake, go to any library around here and you will see this problem. Reflective is next to collaborative. Reflective is next to the touch point. Reflective is next to the presentation space. That can work. That's the one area it can work. Reflective, you know. So this is the issue with libraries. We want a quiet space. So when we treat the building, when Harvey was talking about two floors, maybe one floor is the silent floor. Then that allows us then to have the collaborative, the social, the touch point, the presentation. So that's the secret of doing a flexible space. It's not trying to force, you know, a square peg into a round hole. Does that answer the question?
No.
I guess not.
I don't understand. Are there movable walls or not?
Well, okay.
There could be movable walls.
The prototype that I showed the potential, if you want flexibility, to have movable walls. The movable walls can be acoustically treated or not. Usually we don't.
We're talking about no doors, right?
No, it's not all or nothing.
Yeah.
So there may be areas that have movable walls. Mm-hmm. What Alex is trying to say is that with correct planning of the library, if you put the quiet spaces, if you plan the library such that the quiet spaces are, let's say, on a different floor from the noisier spaces, from the more collaborative spaces, you get that natural acoustic separation. That's a planning thing which would be done. There's also, there are some very high quality movable walls which are acoustically, you know, once they're closed up, they are acoustically sealed. Cost more money, of course. And this is all part of the architectural planning. The laying out, first of all, laying out number one would be to lay it out such that these various functions would be separated appropriately. And then number two, providing the flexibility within, you know, noisy space, you know, another separating on noisy spaces so that they're flexible in size.
Can I just jump in? I happen to have gone to a session that Alex put on in the city at Steelcase, and I saw some of these flexible structures that were, we saw how acoustically isolated they were, and there were various sizes. And I think the flexibility was one that maybe you wouldn't change it every, you know, once a week or anything, but after 2 or 3 years, you might make some changes. So the technology, the furnishings for that kind of thing are out there.
Okay, we're going to pass the mic around. I have a sign-up sheet, and because of the time constraint, I'd like to limit people to 2 minutes, if that's okay, and I'll time it.
Thank you. I have a very simple question. Will there be secure signage so that with a thumbprint, the men and women who are using the library can have full access to their constitutional rights, particularly the Fourth Amendment right to privacy? Property cannot be stolen without first privacy being violated. Now, I've brought this up to the library board before, and I would say I was rather met with hostility. Things like book castles and so on can also be used to track what people are looking at and to block certain people from getting access to certain information. Right now, in the right next door, on the other side of this wall, we have a public access television station, and we cannot pull up full screen from YouTube. This is all to make the producers look amateurish. So I'm telling you, from having lived firsthand experience from IP address discrimination, will the men and women who are using the library not be identified with an IP address that they use but is not their identity?
Okay.
And who also, what is the name of the person responsible for this meeting? Because I'd like to address that question to the person who's responsible for this meeting. Is the person who's responsible for this meeting not here?
Well, let me answer the question because...
Before you answer it, because you're not the person responsible for this
meeting. I think I am.
You are?
I think responsibility for this meeting.
So do you see before you a natural woman and asking this question?
I just want to answer the first question. The first question is
about... You don't see a natural woman standing before you?
Come on.
The issue is something...
You don't see a natural woman. Thank you.
Yeah, the issue is about privacy. And that's a policy question that the library handles. But let me say this from a librarian standpoint. We have conferences where we take stand on privacy all the time. And it's very typical for us to defend privacy in the library, to defend intellectual freedom. So I would say 90% of the librarians that I'm guessing now are the libraries erase the data after anyone's used any of their systems. And the federal government doesn't like this. But in order to continue to have our freedom, we have to take certain stands. So the library represents a big deal here. And that's why we're sitting here, because it represents many layers, from privacy, to be able to search and explore your world without the government intervention, to having spaces to share with your community, to share ideas. And so that's why the spaces are so important. That's why the collections are so important. And that's why we're committed to doing this type of work.
Okay,
Nancy, go. I just want to say, first of all, you said that a book castle would cost $100,000 to maintain over 20 years. So that's $5,000 a year. I crunched the numbers.
Good.
Yeah, $5,000 a year. Secondly, I just have a suggestion. If we go with the whole new building idea, my thought would be it would be really cool if we could get rid of this parking lot and put it behind the new building. I don't know if that's possible, but it would be awfully nice to have Library Lane extend all the library lawn extend all the way to Library Lane. It would just look a lot nicer, and access would be a lot easier, because right now we walk in the middle of the road with cars on either side backing up on us. So it would be safer and more attractive.
So if I can just address that. Library Lane is definitely a problem. When we wrestled with what to do about the current situation, cars, people walking behind cars that are parked, that are backing up, is definitely a safety problem. We didn't feel like it was within our scope to start suggesting closing down Library Lane. That's a town planning issue. And it may well be worth considering if the library could acquire, if Library Lane could be closed off and access to the residences behind, north of the library could be, I believe there's a street further to the west that could connect. If that were an option, and if the library could acquire Library Lane, it opens up a whole new world of planning possibilities. But we didn't feel like it was within our scope to really suggest to do that. As far as the new building behind the existing building, there just isn't. I mean, that was scheme two. There really isn't. If we keep the existing building, the extent you want to keep the existing building, there just isn't the square footage of lot size north of the building that provides for a fully new building.
No, at the new building. If we do a new building, you can kind of, you're not wedded to this footprint. You can kind of shift it forward a little and put the parking behind it.
If it's an all-new building, sure. Well, yes, but then, but don't forget, the more the building moves forward, the more you lose the lawn.
Yeah, well, the lawn would be wider and a little shallower, but and
yes,
safer.
But again, this. So really, that's so. I'm gonna punt on that one. We actually did talk about that early on, but again, getting into these sort of town planning issues, getting beyond the site, the library site, taking over the town's right-of-way, if you will. That's a town planning decision. It's not really something that we could...
Library owns that.
Yeah, they have to move on.
There's a lot...
Okay, do you want to...
Let me ask you, regarding a liability issue, both yours and the library's, the existing entry ramp is not ADA or... is not ADA compliant. There's no handrails, etc. They haven't heard you mention this. Wouldn't that affect the grade of A that was given to that exterior?
Well, first of all, the grading was a public opinion, just a sort of a gut reaction. So when people said gave an A to that front rating, they weren't looking at the legalities, the technicality. People did say, oh, we love this entry, but the door isn't really wide enough for anyone who is disabled or for parents bringing in children in strollers and so forth. So the A in that respect refers really to sort of a gut personal reaction towards the appearance of the entrance. As far as the improving the ADA accessibility, the cost of renovating the concept one, actually any of the concepts that maintain the existing entrance, we took that into account. The site work is part of the cost to improve that ADA ramp and bring it up to code. That's included in the cost.
And I'd just like to say that you are correct to ask that question. It is a liability issue, and I've now said it. because if an accident does happen with someone who's disabled, you can be sued right now with that current condition, correct. Thank you for pointing that out.
Dan, why don't you go?
Thank you for some great work here. In looking at your proposals, I see a different combination.
I can hear you.
I was thanking them for what their work, and in seeing proposals, I see a greater solution, I think, which is a new building on Tinker Street meeting all the needs, keeping the existing library in use during construction, then giving away those buildings for anyone that would like to move them, reclaiming the entire yard area in the rear for both parking and a private courtyard area so that you could have outdoor events with block from the noise of Tinker Street. And then you never have to shut down your library operations. You could have a new building that meets all new environmental needs. And I volunteer to help you with energy efficiency and building material choices to make it a zero energy building or meeting passive house.
Thanks, we offer.
I do want to mention in respect to that of the options that Harvey and I had a conversation last night, and we really, it's option three, has this building on Tinker Street. And although it looks radical on paper, there are a lot of merits to that idea. And because it's the old Yankee Stadium approach, you know, you build the new Yankee Stadium next to the old one, which means you get to keep running your library like it is. And you know, for them, we didn't even notice. The next year we had a new stadium, you know, and they were still knocking down the old stadium. So planning-wise, cost efficiency-wise, option three has the merits. Planning-wise, flexibility-wise, option four has the merits because it's a brand new building. So you know, obviously, when you get a new car, it's going to have extra bells and whistles that you would never have, like a seatbelt, things like that.
The suggestion that was just made, of course, we could go on and on with different options. Of course, we could build an entirely 15,000 square foot new building on the front lawn and then eventually tear down the building in the back. That is of course an option. We didn't present that because of the high value that the community seems to put on the front lawn and the front entrance. So all of our concepts either try to preserve both of those aspects or at least one of those aspects. And hence we came up with the concept four, which preserves the front lawn but doesn't preserve the building. Concept three, of course, preserves only 50% of the lawn but does preserve the building. If you decide that neither the lawn nor the building is important to preserve, then obviously there's a possibility of building in the front.
There's been a number of questions about the book barn and sales. People say they love them, don't want to lose them. They make some money. Why aren't we listing losing the book barn as a con? They're lucrative. And then someone else is saying, the book barn is used by the Friends of the Library. Why should the community be required, have the obligation to pay for its restoration or renovation?
So I think that these, in a sense, are sort of policy questions. First of all, I think that all of the concepts, the two ideal programs, provide space for the Friends of the Library book sale.
Space plus. The ideal program includes double the amount of space for the Friends. And I can understand, architects come up and they come up with these ideas and they come up with, this is a solution. The reason why we do the programming is because we're actually thinking about what is the actual red, white meat on the turkey, What are you actually going to feed to your dinner table? And one of those is that the Friends is a very important, sustainable part of the Library of the Future. We have to be able to raise money through library functions in the future. We can't think that the government is going to come along and give us funding or higher tax dollars. So it really becomes a sustainable solution. So I really applaud the Friends for putting in the time they're putting into, asking the questions they're putting into, as part of it. I don't think it should be a separate project, because I think you got to pool all your funds together to get the project that you need.
And I just want to add to that when we're pricing the renovation of the barn to try to make it a year-round space, the intention is not to make it year-round space for Friends of the Library. It's the intention is to make it year-round space that then some library functions can move into. Some of it may still be used by Friends of the Library, but it would, the whole building, that's in the concept, what we're talking about, the whole interior of the library could be reconfigured, and it simply gives you more conditioned space. So it's not an either-or thing.
And you don't just have to sell books either. You can sell anything you want. So it is potential of being a local store too. That's from your own creative class that's here. And that's a really important piece. That's why we doubled the amount of space for Friends.
Isn't this the Speak or Be Heard section? Am I confusing something here?
Can we go to Jay?
Okay.
Jay, go ahead.
Okay, she just went ahead. Yeah, we're going to alternate here. So yeah, I just waiting patiently. So first of all, I'll stand up. I'm Jay Cohen. I just wanted to thank you guys for doing a very thorough and impressive job. So I have two very objective questions, which happens to deal with your calculations. So if everyone holds up their green sheets, you have the low end, 1.75 million. You have the high end, 5.75 million. That calculates to 3.28 times. So you would think the average cost per homeowner should be similar to 3.28 times. Yet, if you compare what you have on the green sheet, the annual cost for the property owner, $56 for the average cost, and the annual cost for the high end, $81, that's only 1.4 times. So why isn't the average cost for house owner comparable to the cost of the construction, which is 3.2?
It has to do with the bonding and the fact
okay,
that that's what I was trying to say. To the extent that you do new construction, that's what I was trying to, one of the points I was trying to make. The new construction, Class A construction, you can float a bond for, I believe it's 30 years, right?
Okay, I got it.
As
you
opposed
don't have
to the renovation, which is only a 10-year bond.
Okay, so that leads us to leads me to number four in any event. Second question, also kind of an objective mathematical question, is that you concluded that the population, the square footage is based on the population, and you say per capita to square foot for
2 square feet for every 6,000, so you get 12,000, 15,000. But what I'm questioning is, to look at the demographics of that 6,000, I think is very important. I think there's a segment of that 6,000. You could have two populations of 6,000. In one population, you could have 50% of people using the library. And in another, a 6,000, you could have 80% of the people using the library. So unless you have the demographics of who, what segment is not using the library, you really can't come up with an accurate square footage. I mean, if 50% of the people aren't using the, it could be, we could get away with maybe 10,000 square feet. So the question is, can we get a demographics view of who's using the library and who's not? And that could be done with a library card. How many of the 6,000 have library cards and how many are using them?
I'd answer it this way. I think it's a good thought process to try to get your head around who is our community and how will they use the library. I can only say this anecdotally, that you will be a victim of your own success. If you have a brand new library, do you think there'll be more visitors? Yes. If you don't touch your library and it gets old and it's leaking, are you going to have more users?
Absolutely.
No, you're not. You're going to have less and less people are going to use it. So right now, only a fraction of the population is using the library because it hasn't been upgraded in 30 years. The moment you upgrade it, especially, don't forget your name. You know, I come from the outside.
I didn't call library.
All those visitors. We worked on the West Hampton Public Library. Same story. Small library, too small for the community. Build them a bigger library. They're busier than ever. So the worry I get to is, if I don't give you enough options as far as technology is concerned, will I give you enough space to grow into? So if you go for option one, it's really a 10-year play. You renovate the library, you spend $1.75 million, and then 10 years later, you're going to be coming back asking the same questions. We don't have enough space for this or that. I do really think, and I think it's really important, that you get a demographic of your community, you understand who you're talking to, because raising funds is not easy. So you have to reach out to everyone. So I think the intention is right. Thank you.
There's a question about concept number two has a clear relationship to the facilities task force's report findings. Did you consider those?
Yeah, we did. That was part of this whole process. We started out reviewing all the material that was out there, and then we did our own independent investigation. The short answer is yes, that was considered.
Yeah, the task force, I would say that the task force reports and the reports that you've done led us to option one and two. So we didn't jump into new building land until we thought about how the task force had approached it. And that's more of an incremental approach. So option two, 2A, even though this cost escalates because of the integration of the old and the new building, is a good plan. It's pretty straightforward. The question would be, are you going to get everything out of that? Because you're going to have to try to integrate the old with the new. I think it's doable. I came away from the last meeting really thinking option two was the solution. I'm just saying personally. But the more we looked at it, we looked at the numbers, it starts to be more interesting. It's more nuanced now. It's not just knock the back of the building down and rebuild it. It's is that really going to get you a long-term future? You have to remember that we really got to push. It's got to be here for a long time. You can't just build this and then come back to community every 5 minutes and say, we need a new library. We really need to get a good library and get it to roll and really live in it for a long time.
But one way to look at this also, just to help clarify thinking about these different options, in some ways, Concept 2A and Concept 4, the prices are very similar, but they're really very similar schemes. They're both saying, essentially, an all-new building at the back of the site in the same location where the existing is. In that sense, they're very similar schemes. Where they differ is that Concept 2A says, okay, we're going to build an all-new building, but we're going to keep these two little parts that are so beloved by the community, and we're going to try to integrate the new building around them. I think it creates a lot of problems. I think it's up for consideration. But in that respect, you know, in the respect of the siting and the price, they're really kind of parallel schemes. It really could almost be 4 and 4A is another way to look at it.
Yeah,
So I've had a lot of the same ideas that a lot of other people have expressed, and I'll sort of save that. I think that much more could have been done about the parking on site. For example, the old laundromat space, which seems untouched. So that's a head-scratcher for me. But what I really wanted to talk about was comparability. We live in a county that has a lot of libraries. That's very nice. And some of those libraries have been renovated. So I'm hoping that the committee, that either Friends or the task force or somebody, All God's Children, someone is looking at comparable libraries in nearby towns from various perspectives. One, what did they pay to do what they did? Two, or not in that order, two, what did they do? In other words, how much did they use the existing footprint? Did they expand? How much did they expand? And then third, and I think it's really key, how did they pay for it? And I think that whatever we're going to do here, we really owe it to ourselves, as all of the people that are concerned and are here, to explore that before we put a check mark next to any of these particular plans. So I'd like to hear what you... I don't know who's going to answer that. It may not be you folks.
Well, actually, I do have an answer to it, because we're doing a project in the Finger Lakes region, and I was told by that system they have 55 libraries and they're all too small. They're all outdated. So for my business, that's potentially good. But for the communities that are in those 55 communities with all too small, and I live in the Hudson Valley, they haven't been, most of them are too small. So that's why the book castle comes into play, because of ideas like that. One of the reasons why we were selected was because we bring not just a public library knowledge, but a knowledge of all different types of libraries, special libraries. Because I would rather do this library as a special library than as just some mundane public library in a town that's somewhere up the Hudson Valley that doesn't have your people or history. It's completely different. It's like apples to oranges. And so if I told people what I'm working on, a project in Woodstock, they start sparking, you know? I'm not going to pick out another town, but say I pick out my own town. Croton on Hudson. Nobody knows what Croton on Hudson is. Well, Croton, what? You know? Woodstock, they know. So it is important. You have to remember who you are. That is, you can't just settle for the low standard. If you want to, you're there.
I'm not suggesting any low standard. I'm suggesting, though, that it's a big buy.
It's a big buy.
You know, it's for the town. It's a big buy for the taxpayers. And so, and it has implications going forward. So I think we better be looking at the business plan, the business proposition of dollars, space, increased attendance, whatever you want to call it, all these factors, from at least some comparables, from at least a real estate perspective.
Yeah.
What would we be choosing? What would that impact be? What will it do in terms of cost? And how will it be received potentially by taxpayers?
Doug, I think those are great suggestions, and I will certainly, I myself will start looking into doing that comparable study, because that's very valid. And I just want to mention, we're not going to get through all of these questions today, but they are going to be up online. We're going to have this feedback, you know, recorded, and we hopefully will have that kind of information online before we have a public be heard section by the board to just, you know, more fully discuss all of these options and which direction it should, before the board makes a decision. So,
Okay, so two quick questions. When we go on the website, will we see this deck you showed us when we give you our input on the options? Will this deck be on the website?
Yes.
With this deck of charts?
Yes.
So my second question is, when you went through the other options, that all the choices that include keeping the old building, what I wasn't clear on, you did say in there, oh, the old building maintenance problems remain. Are you saying that you're not going to go and renovate the basement? Because it is possible to tear out all that infrastructure stuff and electrical is bad. So the $1.75 million does include fixing the electrical, making it safe, et cetera.
Yes, it includes, I mean, to be, in fact, I presume the physical conditions report is online?
Yes.
We have a copy.
So it includes everything. If you look at the physical conditions report, there's a page or two of what we recommend needs to be done, and that's all, everything's, that part includes everything that's on the physical conditions report.
Okay, well, then
including
the
relocating mechanical, relocating electrical, upgrading electrical, all that's included.
Okay, but you make the comment on those choices, the old building maintenance remains, but you've solved the unsafe pieces.
Oh yes, the unsafe pieces, yes, the immediate unsafe pieces are rectified. When I say it's old maintenance, it's an old building. There's going to be maintenance issues. We're going to bring it up just, and the example I use is we did not, other than some incremental repairs and spots, we did not include a new roof. Because again, you still have, I'm going to say, about 10 to 15 years left on the roof that's there. So the roofing is not included, but you're going 10 years from now, 15 years from now, you're going to need to replace the roof. So that's the kind of thing that's going to be ongoing no matter what.
Okay, thank you.
There's a couple of questions here. How can a brand new building respect the fact that the exterior entrance is seen by the community as an A space? And how would you make the new building architecturally fit the town?
Well, that's the million-dollar question, right? We present that there's only one option that gets rid of the existing entrance, and that's concept number four. We present that because I think it's worthy of consideration. It's out there. If the decision is to keep that you want to keep the existing entrance at all costs, then don't do concept four. Concept four maintains the lawn, which is the other big piece that everybody seemed to like. And I think the end, architecturally, there's a whole range of architectural solutions, and we didn't get into that, but that would obviously be an important factor that would be considered when we get into the design of it. We would be presenting options. If you decide to go with concept four, we would then work to make that fit the community in every possible way. And I feel confident that we could with it.
Sam?
Thank you very much. You've actually addressed a number of issues for the community to mull over. The big elephant in the room, or the big book in the library, is the financial aspect, and what can this community actually pass a bond for, which everyone here, and that's the question. We can all dream. Have you seen circumstances where there was a marriage between the frugal approach that a community can bear the price for, such as like the $1.5 million? I think the community could go for that, and it seemed like somewhere one of your options. But and then have the remaining $2.6 million or so raised through funding and other sources, so that this community, knowing that at least the library will be improved and renovated, but it's a marriage of the people who are worried about keeping their homes, and believe it or not, I've run across this in other projects. There are wealthy people here who could afford, but prefer to not have their taxes go through the roof and so on. So. Having a solution, a strategic solution financially, where the community says, okay, the investment is to put $1.5 million to improve the library, but they also are taking the opportunity to raise the other $2.6 million. And I would hope you have some examples of places where you saw that kind of thing happen. For instance, this building, I believe the community was asked to pass a bond that was about $1 million. But this building cost more than $1 billion. And other monies, grants, and other funds were used to cover the difference. I was very reluctant to even consider the new building on the front lawn. But something
2 minutes is up.
Okay, would you tell me how many parking spaces would be made available if the book barn
taken out? We didn't really. Parking is it's such a limited site. We really did not analyze parking. We there's certain numbers. The zoning code has a calculation. We can provide those numbers. We will provide those numbers if questions asked. We'll provide that going forward. The question is, where would those parking spaces be? It's very difficult to get onto this site. This existing plan actually isn't totally accurate. There are some parking spaces currently on your 6th Library Lane site. I'm quite sure the count of that. But it's a very limited area for parking. Parking is just going to have to be, in any of these concepts, has to be off-site. We'll have to use presumably the public lot off Camo Drive parking.
So I want to answer the question about public-private partnership, because this is a perfect example of marrying the two. So I agree with you. It's going to be difficult to get the community to pony up for, and the tax dollars to pony up for the full cost of this. So that's going to require a public-private partnership, which can be formed in many different ways. So an example, a couple examples of how you get this done. The first is that the parents with children are the most important, really, future of this community. So having, in Sayville, New York, we were successful in passing a bond by doing a Halloween parade and then having the vote on the same day. And let me say that they had someone going around town saying, stop the library. But nobody is going to stop a group of families coming through town, with their kids in costumes. It was absolutely charming. It's one of the most successful pieces, so it's timing, that's one. When you want public-private partnership, you want the right timing. The second example is we worked on a project in Grand Teton in Wyoming, and that project, they had something called Old Bill's Run. And so what you do is you have a fun run, and it's a whole event and festival focused on it, and every group in the town, has a run. Now, I know Grand Teton's bigger than it is here, but it's still that kind of idea of having a run, having an event. So that was a successful. Plus, they also put up a wall of honor and that with a sculpture that had all of the community members' names on it. So again, how are you, as a citizen of your community, not going to have a name on the front lawn of your community? I mean, it's a huge honor to be part of it. So in investing in your community has to be an honor. So that's part of it. Now, the last part I'll just say is that when you're doing a public-private partnership, it's always good to get a fundraising consultant, someone who understands fundraising. I am not that person. That's not what I do. I do library programming. But there are people that exist out there who just focus on fundraising. And the things that I've learned from them is, no one is going to invest in an organization that's failing. So you have to be able to show people that you're succeeding. And so that's part of it. The other is when they do programs, there's a $1,000 table next to a $200 table. And you do a big event in the library where you feed people. The people who are sitting in the $200 seats look over to the $1,000 seats and they go, I should have given more. That's kind of the psychology of it. So it's a little bit of psychology, but it's getting the right talent in mind. So I think you're ahead of the game there. This plan, in order to get the finances right, there has to be a robust fundraising campaign. And there are people in this community who can't afford it. They just want to be appreciated to be part of it. They want to be brought into it.
Hi, how are you? So I'm a regular user of the library. I've been using it for a few years now. And watching this project with some interest, I am frankly appalled that the historical provenance of the building
is in question at this late stage of these deliberations. The good lady at the front says that the L dates from the period of 1812. So we've got part of the building that this woman says is part was built during the War of 1812. That's important. I read in the Woodstock Times that some rooms may date to 1775. No one knows if that's true or not.
No. Can I just answer that?
Sure.
The original building that was at late 1700s, was completely torn down. Alf Evers has in his book when the 1967 present front of the library was built. They completely wiped out that original farmhouse. And all that remains is a little tiny L that was added to it by Dr. Hall in 1812. So I just want to say that I've been an advocate for, in any of these plans, that we save that L and use it somewhere because it is historic. But that is the only part of that building that has any historical significance.
Okay. Other folks said that part of the building dates to 1922. Madam, is that correct? Okay, so we have these divergent, ideas of when the building dates from floating around. You know, I also wanted to mention that, you know, the library isn't just about books. I built my business there and successfully became a homeowner using the library. It literally helped me immensely in a way that is not literary related. I grew up using a very small library. I came here from across the river over in Columbia County where I made, you know, some use of the library in Claverack. I want to say that I disagree with the gentleman's viewpoint that having an old library causes a drop in users. It doesn't. The same people that are in the community are going to keep using it. If that's your town library, people are going to go there. I will say if you have a bigger, nicer library, you will get more people coming. I am also deeply concerned about the architectural facade. Certainly no one wants to see something that looks like it belongs in a rest area on the New York State Thruway on Tinker Street, so, you know, no consideration seems to have been made for that. I noticed that none of the plans make use of the stream. The stream is a really great resource. If the stream could be made use of in terms of the campus concept, I think that would be great. Ms. Gloria also mentioned something about biometrics. That's important if the community is going to protect the privacy of its members. We live in a liberty-denuded time, and I would suggest that there needs to be some provision made for anonymous research. When I do research on something, I don't think other people have a right to know what it was that I was researching.
First, we've got a couple of questions here. Why do we need more collections when we have the interlibrary loan system? Why not have fewer collections and train our patrons on using the interlibrary loan system?
So over the next, I guess my rhetorical question back to that question about collections is, then if you're stating that the collections should stay the same or be smaller, then number one, you can rely on other libraries having your collections, which is fine. Interlibrary loan is an excellent service. Number two, are you saying to me in the next 50 years you're not going to grow your collection? Who asked the question? So, I mean, if we don't increase the size of storage, that means every book that goes in, one book has to come out. So I think you've got to build a little storage into your future. That's all. And I also want to mention that standing up here, it's not easy to say everything correct, you know, to get everything right. And it's easy to be misunderstood. I love small libraries. I was just talking about the time between the last renovation of that library and a new renovation. The moment you do a new renovation, new users are going to try to use it. For an old library that hasn't been touched in 30 years, it's almost like a club. Everybody knows each other, because they're the ones who found this wonderful place. But think about all the other people who don't use it because their trust has been broken, because it doesn't match their needs. It doesn't do anything for them. So there's a whole swath of this community that are not using this library because it's not doing the thing, doing what it needs. And I'll give you a good example. I went into another library down in New Jersey just last week, and the place was filled with kids doing tutoring. There must have been 8 seats, each a kid with a tutor. That doesn't happen at your library. You don't have enough space to have 8 different tutoring sessions to go on at once. Our program will give you that. That's why we're talking about this. So when we looked at all the pieces, all that white meat on the turkey, we want to make sure that we give you the pieces that you don't have. We know you have lots that work. It's just, for how long? You know, is it a 10-year play? In this case, you're on a 6-month, you know, now you're in a 6-month mode. Can we get you to a 50-year move so that the library just functions and you can grow your community, grow your collection? That's what we want to do.
I want to just very, very briefly reemphasize that none of these are architectural designs. They're not they're certainly not finished architectural designs. They're not schematic, what we call schematic architectural designs, which would be the next phase. They're concepts. They're simply masses, blocks, placed on the site in different ways just to help you visualize what could be built. And they're not to be taken in any you can't look at, and it's very hard for people to understand. They're not in any way recommendations of what the building should look like. The building in the front, the new building in the back could be something completely different. It could be a glass box, it could be a wood clad with shed roofs. There's all sorts of different configurations. And the decision that needs to be made right now is which concept you want to go with, where you want to place, how many square feet do you want to build, what program you want to use. And then with that information, we go to the next step. We start to come up with schematic designs with the drawings, the renderings, that you can actually see what it looks like.
I just want to say, I think we've got time for one more question. We have to be
out of here. We only have 2 more speakers on the list.
Okay, well, Joe, go ahead.
Okay. First, my name is Joe Mangan. I was the facility group that recommended the master plan. I think you guys are doing a good job. You're doing exactly what you should be doing. And I just want to talk about concept 3, the new building. If we do a new building, I think there's 2 things about concept 3 I like. Number one, it creates a courtyard that's isolated from noise, street noise on 3 sides. The second thing, it doesn't require the library to move off site. A variation of that I think you should consider is to put the new building on the front lawn. Then, when that's finished and the library can move into it, do a second phase, rip down the old building, and do a second phase new building. It creates the courtyard, and it allows you to not deal with an old building or renovation.
Well,
so it's a variation on concept 3, but I think the courtyard is an excellent idea. The road is just going to get busier over the years, and a quiet courtyard isolated from traffic is a good idea.
Thank you.
The courtyard could also have a covering, too. So the courtyard could have a covering, so Tom, when it rains, you can still have the festival when it's raining, so you can bring it out. And the art walk can be open or closed. And we did that project in Fort Collins, the Old Town Library, and it's next to a museum. So that's where that idea came from. And it's a really great way to connect it, especially in the wintertime, to be able to walk through the 2 buildings and have local art there. So it's kind of a cool concept.
Okay, last speaker.
Hi, everybody. Number one, our current library buildings are sitting and rotting. You saw that, okay? In the matter that, as was just stated, as far as the new building is concerned, it will be above the lake that this town sits on. We're in the valley here. And that anything that we invest in that renovation of the old building isn't going to last. It just can't. You know, if it had steel girders, we could raise the whole thing up and go from there. And the most important part, and we don't have that population sitting in this room of the young people, that probably in most cases don't have much opinion, but there might be. You know, the matter of the worrying about the taxes. I wouldn't be standing up here if it hadn't been for libraries, okay? I came out of the Depression. And I can tell you the only reason that I am here in Woodstock, in my own home, is because of books. And it is so important for us to stop squabbling about this situation so that those parents that are bringing their kids in, and with a new building, we will get more and more. And I'm not denying thus old folks, okay, won't be using the library more. We need the meeting spaces. There's been questions in the past about that one. We've got one more public building that I hope I might open up one of these days, even though I'm supposed to be retired. Thanks.
Thank you all for coming.
Thank you all for coming and caring and continuing to care.
And we will be putting your questions and answers to them online so everyone can see them. We didn't get to everything, but we will.